маємо нагоду почути доктора Девіда Ортона, колегу з Йоркського університету, з доповіддю археології чорних рис у античній та середньовічній Європі. Thank you, David, for this opportunity to, for us to listen your talk and your most welcome.
Thank you very much, Tada, and thank you for the opportunity to come and give this talk. So I wasn't sure today exactly what kind of an audience I would have in terms of zoologists, zooarchaeologists, archaeologists, and so on. So I'm going to try to give this talk for a, let's say, for a broad audience, not assuming that you either know the zoology or know the archaeology. Some of you would like. Okay, so this talk relates to a small project that I have going on at the moment, which is the reason why I'm currently in Kiev, which is not focused on Ukrainian material. It's focused, it's covering material from all over Europe, but particularly looking at places where there isn't much published data already, and Ukraine is one of those places. And I'll explain all this as I go along. But I just want to be clear at the beginning that I won't, this is not going to be a talk focusing on the work I've been doing here in Kiev, although I will mention that at the end. In fact, I'm going to focus quite a bit of my talk on Northern Europe, where I've done the most research so far, and then explain from there why Ukrainian material becomes relevant to Northern Europe. So, outline of the talk, I'll start off with some basic background as to why I'm interested as an archaeologist, and I myself am from an archaeological background. I work in an archaeology department. I just happen to work with animal bones. So I'm not from a zoological background. So I'll start by talking a little bit about why I'm interested in looking at ancient rat bones. I'll say a little bit about what we know about rats, about the dispersal of black rats around the world from modern genetics. And then I'll move into the archaeological evidence for the earliest finds of black rats around Europe and their subsequent history in Europe. As I said before, I'll then give something of a slightly more detailed case study of the north of Europe, where I know the material the best. And then I have a couple of final points I'd like to make, which aren't really the main thrust of this talk, but which are quite interesting, I think, especially to a broad audience. So one is the connection between rats and plague, and the other one is the other major European rat species, the brown rat or the grey rat, Rattus norvegicus. Okay. So why I would be interested in rats as an archaeologist? Well, there are really four main reasons why an archaeologist might be interested in species like rats, or for that matter, the house mouse, Mus musculus, in commensal species. So in rodent species, not necessarily rodent species, but in this case, rodent species which live in and around human settlements, and which can often become dependent to some extent on the environments that humans create. Perhaps the most obvious thing that comes up whenever I talk to, especially to people who are not archaeologists or historians or zoologists about rats, the first thing that comes to mind is often disease, and particularly, of course, plague, Yersinia pestis, the Black Death. What comes to mind more for archaeologists is often reconstructing environments. So the majority of archaeologists who study small mammals, rodents and other small mammals, are doing it in order to reconstruct environments. Now, most of the time that people study small mammals, they're doing it in prehistory, and it's an attempt to study kind of broad environments around settlements, environmental reconstruction on kind of a landscape scale. When you start looking at commensal species, and things like mice and rats, you're very often looking at reconstructing environments on a much more focused scale of the environments around, in and around human settlements themselves. Yeah, so, for example, this reconstruction is of Viking Age York, Jorvik. There is a famous museum in York, where I'm from, or where I'm working, the Jorvik Viking Centre, which has a reconstruction and lots of kind of animated models and so on of people living in Viking York. They include, amongst other things, rats in their scene around York, because we found them there archaeologically. So they consulted with the archaeologists who said they had rats present, so when they reconstruct what the city was like, they include rats. The other main reasons people look at commensal species in archaeology, one of them is to look at migration. So this has particularly been used in island settings. So for example, this picture here is Polynesia. People have used the Pacific wrap, for example, which is a species of wrap we find in Southeast Asia and onto the Pacific Islands. They've used it to track human dispersal. So particularly using genetics, you can see the process by which rodents have reached one island and then the next island and so on. And you can use that as a proxy for the way that humans have moved. Slightly more subtle than that, but what I'm personally most interested in is actually looking at not at initial colonization by animals or for that matter by people, but looking at trade and communications. So looking at the extent to which different settlements in the antique period and the medieval period were connected to each other and connected to the world outside. And I'll explain why I think bats are useful for that now. Okay, so a common theme that comes up here is the idea of human-mediated dispersal. So there are animals which humans have deliberately moved around the world. So domestic species, livestock, we were talking about chickens earlier. Chickens have been moved around the world from South Asia originally by humans as animals that they're deliberately using. There are other species which have moved around the world with humans, but not due to the humans' deliberate intentions. And rats obviously fall into that category. Now where the ability to colonize a human settlement environment allows an animal to spread outside its original native range, you can get a situation emerging where that species is to some extent dependent on the environments created by humans. So you get this idea of afro-dependent populations. So it doesn't mean they can't live away from humans, but it means that over the long term, populations are unlikely to be sustained away from human settlements, which is what I think is the situation with rats in Europe, but certainly with the black rats in Europe. Archaeologically speaking, where you find those species, so if I find black rats, which as you'll see in a moment, are originally from South Asia, if I find black rats in a settlement in Finland, that's a pretty good evidence. Firstly, that the human settlement created the right conditions for rats, so a suitably dense settlement with shelter, with food and so on, suitable for rats, but also it's evidence of that colonization opportunity, that there was the movement of humans that allowed rats to get there in the first place. Because we're not talking about animals that can move long distances on their own accord. So people have used this a lot. And as I mentioned just now, people have most often used rats to look at human dispersals in places like the Pacific. More recently, there was this paper on the right here that came out last year, which looked at both chickens and rats and used them as evidence for trade contacts between the Arabian Peninsula in southern India and East Africa. So the first arrival of black rats, which are an Asian species to begin with, in East Africa, seems to coincide with the expansion of Arab trade. So in the period that we would call medieval in Europe, they're often, sometimes it's called the medieval in Africa, sometimes they use other terminology, but around kind of the 10th century and onwards. Okay, so for the uninitiated, the two species of rat that we find in Europe today firstly the Rattus norvegicus, the brown rat or the grey rat, in English often called the common rat or the Norway rat, which it depends. I'm going to come back to brown rats a little bit at the end. They're not the point of this talk. But there is a lot of disagreement about precisely when they did reach Europe. In Western Europe, we tend to say 17th, 18th century they arrived. The assumption seems to be that they came overland from Asia, although, as I'll mention again at the end, I'm not sure about that. This is a species probably from relatively far north in Asia, which thrives in temperate conditions. It's larger, it's also more aggressive than the black rat, and it's the main species in Europe today. So in large parts of Europe, it is now the only species of rat. So in most of northern Europe, in almost all of Britain, we no longer have black rats, we only have brown rats. So I'm not sure quite what the situation is in Ukraine, but most places I go to talk, I always say to the audience, if you see rats around in your day-to-day life, they're probably brown rats. Okay. Is that the case here? Do you mainly have brown rats in Ukraine these days?
Yes, they're not shown.
But the species I'm actually more interested in archaeologically is Rattus rattus, the black rat, also known in English as the ship rat or the roof rat, in both cases related to the fact that it's actually a very good climber, that in the wild climb trees fairly often, and when living in human settlements is often found in the roof. It's originally from South Asia, and I'll come to that in a bit more detail in a second. It's a smaller species, it's less aggressive, it's less cold adapted, and in recent centuries it seems to have been widely replaced by the brown rat across most of Europe. Now my argument is that because this species is not actually that well adapted to the European climate, it's a good proxy for human activity. So where we find black rats in archaeological sites, we know that we have the right kind of settlement, but probably also that we have regular contact between settlements, because over the long term, it would be unlikely to survive without some form of population exchange. Okay. So what we actually know so far about the spread of black rat, there's been remarkably little modern DNA work done. Now, the brown rat is one of the genetically best known species in the world because it is the lab rat. So the lab rat is the speaking. There actually isn't much research on the brown rat in the wild, but there is a huge amount under laboratory conditions. The black rat has barely been studied genetically at all. There is very little research. This is a paper from 2011. There have been a few more studies since, but this still basically summarizes most of what we know. So that gives you some idea how little we know about black rat genetics. The key point here is there are actually, I think, 6 or 7 lineages of black rats, most of which are confined to Southeast Asia, and I won't talk about any more because they never left Southeast Asia. However, lineage 1 and lineage 2, lineage 1 in blue, lineage 2 in red, are the lineages which have spread further around the world. And in particular, lineage 1 seems to have started in South Asia, South India, and that's the variant that appears to have reached Europe. So black rat that have been, modern black rat that have been sampled in Europe, appear to be descended from black rat from India, whereas those that you find way down into island Southeast Asia seem to have come from mainland Southeast Asia previously. There is then a separation between a Madagascan sublineage and a European sublineage of lineage 1. So it appears that fairly early on there was a break. Now what you might notice on here is we actually only have one data point from Europe. That is not a single specimen, that is a single study. A few years after this study, that one data point was expanded, but nonetheless, the only modern DNA we have from Europe is from the central Mediterranean. This was an Italian team, so as you can see, most of the samples are from Italy, but they also have some from southern France and from North Africa. What this showed is that there appears to have been a genetic radiation in the central Mediterranean basin. They conclude, based on this, a single, quote, fairly recent invasion. So the argument here is that all the sites they sampled around the central Mediterranean show that there had probably been a single, and this is just kind of old-fashioned mitochondrial DNA haplogroups. Nobody has done full genome work on black rats yet. In fact, there isn't a published genome for black rats, although there is one that has just been sequenced and hopefully will be published soon by the Max Planck in Jena. So just based on traditional mitochondrial haplogroups, it looks like there is this expansion in the central Mediterranean. So the argument is there was a single invasion at some point in the recent past, and they don't specify how long ago they think recent might be. That has then resulted in the population of much of the central Mediterranean. Okay. So that doesn't tell us very much. If you're taking away from this that we really don't seem to know much about it, that's exactly the right thing to take away. We don't know much about the genetics at all. Which is why I think it's important. I think it would be important to turn to the archaeological data anyway, but it's particularly important given how little we know from this. And at this point I want to emphasise that I'm not the first person to look at this. There have been various people in the past who have summarised the archaeological data. These are three of the key studies here. It's Professor Philip Armitage, who studied some material from York and from London, and then kind of did a study where he expanded out beyond that. There is a big paper by a French team from 1994. This is actually not the original, this is 1997, I think, but they had a series of papers in the 90s where they surveyed a lot of the data from Western Europe in particular. And then there's a paper by Michael McCormick, the historian, which is, up until now, the most thorough, the most complete survey that's been done. He published that in 2003. 10 years later, he put the database online, so there is an online database of all the samples he included in this. So what I've been doing is taking these existing databases adding to them, expanding to countries that weren't represented in any of the previous studies, and also going back and checking some of the older sources. And inevitably, in any kind of fairly large database, and I should say that McCormick built on Bonrozo and Vinn's work, there are some mistakes in this database. That's inevitable. If you compile a database, you'll make mistakes. And some of them actually change the story a little bit when you go back and correct them. Okay, so with no further ado, I'll give you an idea of what the archaeological data actually say. Now, the first thing I should mention is that there is some evidence for Pleistocene specimens of Rattus in some parts of Europe. I'm not going to get into that. I don't know how solid that evidence is. In any case, I'm only going to talk about Holocene. So there may or may not have been some kind of Rattus, not necessarily Rattus rattus, in the Pleistocene, but I'm not going to talk about that. Moving to the Holocene, there are actually very few finds from before the current era, so before 1 AD. I've plotted a few of them on here. This is not exhaustive. I haven't been focusing on the earliest finds, the later ones. But the colour scheme here are red finds are ones that are reported, but that I don't trust. And in many cases, the people who publish them also don't trust them, so they say, for example, this site down here, Capo da Fieri in Italy, I think that's the name of the site. The zooarchaeologist who studied it actually says, you know, well, we found black rat here, but this is a Neolithic site, so I don't actually believe it's really there. It must be intrusive. So the red dots are dots that either the original publisher or I don't believe in. Yellow dots are slightly more secure cases. This one, for example, is underneath Pompeii. It's not in the final phase of Pompeii, it's in an earlier phase, but that makes it pretty secure. This Egyptian case is actually inside a mummy. So again, that makes it fairly secure. And this is only 1st century BC and is from a very good context in Morocco. The two green points here have been carbon dated. Now the key point here is that all of the more reliable finds, with the exception of this one in Stellina, in fact, all of the more reliable finds are from the last few centuries BC. So from kind of 400 BC to, you know, 50 BC maybe, including both the carbon dated finds. So probably we're talking about black rat reaching the Mediterranean in the second half of the first millennium BC. So after about 500 BC. Okay. Then, if you move into what I'm calling the Roman period, now bear in mind, I'm being very Anglo-centric here because the Roman invasion of England is in 43 AD, so I kind of think of Roman as starting at 1. Obviously, actually, the Roman period goes several centuries earlier. But nonetheless, if we move up to the Imperial Roman period, we find suddenly there are rats over a very large area of Europe, and an area which almost entirely coincides with the Roman Empire. So there is this one case. I want to get hold of these in carbon data just to make sure, but there is only really one find that is firmly outside the Roman Empire. Now, why do we have this pattern? Well, given what we know of the ecology of the black rat, this actually makes a lot of sense. We know that in the Roman period, in much of Europe, you start to get larger, denser settlements than you previously had. That's not necessarily the case in all of the Mediterranean, but certainly in northwest Europe, Iron Age settlements are very rarely on the scale of Roman towns. We know that you start to get regular bulk trade, including both commercial bulk trade and kind of, let's say, government-facilitated, state-organized bulk provisioning as well. You have regular military supply lines, and this is something which is a bit of a cliche. Whenever you talk about the Romans, people want to talk about the army, but on the other hand, you did have a very large body of soldiery who were supplied in a very organized manner with substantial pack trains, and all of that involved moving perishable goods along efficient roads, long distances, in wheeled vehicles and on boats, all of which are very good ways of spreading mice and rats around Europe. On top of all that, the Roman period is a period of relative climatic warmth. So you have, again, if we're talking about a species which is not originally adapted to a temperate European climate, the fact that the Roman period is relatively warm may also have assisted this process. Nonetheless, I think more important is this issue of settlements and trade. And what I would argue is that while we don't only find rats in big cities, we also find rats in some Roman villas, particularly in the late Roman period. The Roman villas, while they're quite small settlements, they are also tend to be very well connected. So they tend to have very regular, they kind of act as hubs of trade in some cases, but they certainly are well provisioned from outside. So they tend to be on trade routes, often on rivers, and and you have a lot of goods coming in and out. So my argument here, and I'm certainly not the first person to argue this, but the argument here is that rat populations in this period were dependent on the Roman economic system as a whole. So the combination of the settlement pattern and the amount of communications and trade. Now obviously that system eventually breaks down. So the question then is what happens to rats when that Roman economic system starts to fall apart from kind of the 5th century onwards? And for this I'm zooming in on some kind of 200 year blocks. 300 year blocks rather. So this is the last three centuries of kind of the classical Roman period. Obviously when you decide the Roman period ends is a matter of opinion, but I'm saying 3rd to 5th centuries. The last 300 years, as you can see, we have a lot of rat finds along the frontiers, along the Rhine frontier and the Danube frontier, and a significant number elsewhere in the empire as well. If we move into the 6th to 8th century, we have almost none at all north of the Mediterranean. This find, I should say, from this, is actually probably later. So it's from a relatively early layer, but the people who published it, it's Olga Krajewicz and Arkady Savinetsky, argue that actually, even though it's from that layer, there is some mixing, and probably the rat bones are actually from the 12th to 13th century layers. Hopefully they're going to send me one of the bones and we're going to get it dated to find out. But I put this here because technically it is from that layer, but it's probably actually a later find. So instead, we only have a couple of finds. I have no particular reason to doubt these finds. This, the dating is quite questionable again. It's probably 8th century, but it might be later. But it's certainly towards the end of this period in any case. Okay, so it seems we have a period after the end of the Roman Empire where we still have rats on various places in the Mediterranean. We still have them in quite a few Byzantine sites, but we're not finding them in Northern Europe. And I should say, if you look at Iberia here, we have no data from Iberia, but we also have virtually no sites that have been studied, you know, where they have studied the microfauna. So I wouldn't take this seriously. We don't know if there were rats in Iberia or not. We don't have positive evidence or negative evidence. But for Northern Europe, lots of sites have been studied, and we just don't seem to have rats in this period. So when the Roman system collapses, at least in the north of Europe, the ability for rat populations to survive seems to go along with it. But then something quite interesting happens, which is if you move into the 9th to 11th centuries, we suddenly get a whole load more data, we suddenly get a whole load more finds of rats, and particularly in the north of Europe. So actually now we don't have any data from the Mediterranean. Now there are two possible things going on here. One is that from the 7th, from the 8th century onwards, there is a massive loss of, the Byzantine Empire loses a lot of land in the Balkans, and also there is a breakup of Mediterranean trade related to the oil, a breakup of Roman-dominated, European-dominated Mediterranean trade, due to the Arab invasions of North Africa and Iberia. More importantly, I think, though, there is the fact that in much of southern Europe, medieval archaeologists are less inclined to sieve their bones than Roman archaeologists. Whereas in northern Europe, medieval archaeologists seem to be more inclined to sieve their bones than Roman, sieve their finds than Roman archaeologists. So actually, I think the lack of data from southern Europe in this period is probably a research bias. You know, I would like to think it's to do with the Slavic invasions of the Balkans and the Arab invasions of North Africa, but that is probably overinterpreting. It's probably simply that people haven't been doing such intensive sieving of archaeological deposits in this period. So one thing I would like to do with this project is to fill in some of those gaps, particularly in Iberia. Okay. Now, you'll have noticed, hopefully, that all of these, the way I've plotted this data is using the midpoints of the date ranges. Now, that's obviously problematic because archaeological dating is often quite vague, so many of these points might actually have ended up on the wrong maps. You know, if they're dated 7th to 9th century, but actually they date to the very beginning of the 7th century, they're going to turn up on the wrong map. So that's all a bit problematic. So one thing I've been working on is using the plotting frequency curves over time, incorporating dating uncertainty instead. So doing a simulation where you take the date range for every find, and you simulate dates within that, you run it 2,000 times, 5,000 times, whatever you need for it to resolve, and then you can plot frequencies with a confidence interval around them. And what we see from this, and I should say this is an unclean data set, it's a work in progress, none of these results are final. I suspect quite a lot of these finds actually are going to get resolved when we check them. But what we see quite clearly is this 5th century, or rather decline from the 5th into the 6th century across the whole of Europe. If we split northern and southern Europe based on above or below 47 degrees north, which is pretty arbitrary, again, we see this kind of 6th century decline in the north, and we see a much later 8th century decline in the south. But again, I suspect that's more research bias than anything else. In both cases, we see the numbers going right back up in the high medieval period. If we break northern Europe down a bit, and apologies if you can't read the writing on here, the green at the top is England, then we have Belgium and the Netherlands, then we have France, and then we have Scandinavia and the Baltic countries at the bottom. You can see that there are some slightly different timings to when we stop seeing evidence for rats in the different countries that were part of the Roman world. And in the far north, in Scandinavia and the Baltic states, which are not part of the Roman world, we first start to see rats appearing in any decent numbers, any decreasing degree of confidence, into the 9th century. Okay, so what I'm going to do for the next part of the talk is focus on this northern European picture, because it is, for the medieval period at least, where we have the most, data, basically, where we have the most thorough coverage of data. And also it tells quite an interesting story. So I'm going to start off very parochially, very Anglocentrically from Britain, justify that on the basis that a lot of the early research on rat biogeography was done based in Britain. And in fact, there was a find from London, actually a find from York, which was the first concrete evidence of rats before the medieval period in Europe. So the first kind of concretely published find from the Roman period. Or so I thought, until I saw, I'm going to mispronounce the name, but Peter Blitchcock, who actually published rats from 1956. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So actually, there were published Roman rats from Ukraine well before any of the stuff done in Britain. However, that's not widely known outside Ukraine. So a lot of the kind of the more visible early publications are from Britain. So we have rats in a lot of Roman towns in Britain. We have them in Aboricum, otherwise known as York. We have them in Londinium, otherwise known as London. We also have them in quite a few smaller towns, in a few Roman villas and so on. We don't have them in every town. So Winchester, for example, was quite a large Roman town, but also quite isolated. It wasn't a port, it was further inland, and we don't find them there. So it seems that communication routes are as important as the size of the town. If we go to post-Roman England, well, there is a lot of controversy, there is a lot of argument amongst people who study the Roman period and the early medieval period about the extent to which this idea of the Roman Empire collapsing completely in the big Dark Age is really valid. If there is one place in Europe where that is really valid, or most valid, then it is Britain. So the most extreme case of change between the Roman period and the subsequent period is Britain. We virtually cease to see urban settlements overnight. There are massive changes in material culture, there are massive changes in pretty much any type of archaeology you care to mention, very rapidly at the end of the Roman period. So the settlement, the nature of settlements changes enormously, and the degree of trade reduces enormously. And unsurprisingly, therefore, we see in post-Roman England that there are very few, if any, rats. There are a few claimed specimens, all of which that I've looked at so far closely have something dubious about them. So that's the kind of the immediately post-Roman period. Not surprising that we don't have rats. Once you get to the 7th and 8th centuries, we actually start to see the development of a fairly extensive trade network across northern Europe, around the North Sea and around the Baltic Sea, known as the Northern Emporia. Now two of those, or several of those Emporia, were Saxon settlements referred to as Wicks, which there are at least four major Wicks in England, and there's also Quentavic in France. The two which have had the most intensive research done on them are, again, York and London. So Aelfawick is late Saxon York, or mid-Saxon rather. London Wick is mid-Saxon London. And these are both sites which have had plenty of study of small mammals, and there are plenty of mice in each case, but there are no known rats in each case. So even when we start to see this extensive trade network developing across northern Europe, we don't see the return of rats. If we cross the channel to continental Europe, Ribe on the Danish coast, same story, we don't see any rats. Thorestad, a particularly large trading settlement in the Netherlands, again we don't see any rats. I should add though, there's not been much study of microfauna here. The recovery wasn't amazing. So both of these sites do have mouse specimens recorded, but only very small numbers. So I'm not so sure about these as I am about the two English sites. And I could list a load more sites where this applies to, but these are just some of the biggest, best known sites. Then, if we move into the 9th century, and particularly into the middle and the mid and the end of the 9th century, we start to see rats appearing again. And they appear at York, in Jorvik, so the Anglo-Scandinavian levels of York, the Viking Age levels of York. They appear in Birka, which is up here near Stockholm, a big Viking Age trading settlement again from the, I think 829 is the beginning of the dating for the first phase that has any rats in, so mid-9th century. And probably also in Hellebu. So there are lots of rats reported from Hellebu, which is, it's a Danish settlement, it's now in Germany, but Hellebu is the Danish name. There are lots of rats reported, but the zooarchaeologists who reported them didn't refer to the phasing of the site. So within the about 200 years it's occupied, I don't know exactly when those bones are. So they might be earlier than Birka and York, if they're from the very earliest phase, or they might be later if they're from the very latest phase. I don't know. But they're certainly consistent with the same pattern. So what I kind of suggest based on this, and based on a few other less well-known settlements with less good dating and that kind of thing, is that we may have basically a 9th century Viking Age rat horizon. So where rats reappear across Northern Europe fairly rapidly in the mid-9th century. So you know, we have no firm finds before about here. Birka is one of the earliest. And then after that, we start to see them coming in more and more sites. So we need to get more data to fill this out, and we particularly need more data from the eastern part of the Baltic. But based on kind of fairly well-known, well-published sites, it looks like there may be this Viking Age phenomenon. And that then raises the question of what was the route by which they spread. So from the point of view of somebody looking at Jorvik, looking at York, if you think, well, suddenly, you know, we had Roman rats, they went away in the Saxon period, they came back with the Vikings, the assumption would be if they came with the Vikings, they're coming from the Baltic. But the Baltic is an even more unexpected place to find what is essentially a South Indian species turning up in the 9th century. So the question then is, how did they get to the Baltic? And there are really two possibilities here. One is that actually there was a revival of rat populations in France, in the Carolingian world, so what you might call the Carolingian Renaissance of rats, and that they then spread back up into the Baltic secondarily after reaching Western Europe. The other possibility is that they reached the Eastern Baltic via the riverine trade along the Volga and the Daugava and Dnieper, which starts to lead you to realise why I'm in Ukraine at the moment. In which case we'd have a westerly spread. So, I have a small project funded by the British Academy where I'm trying to resolve this question as far as we can. And this is a very small pilot project, we don't have money to do any DNA or anything like that, although we have done some pilot DNA, but we can't do anything substantial. But the idea here is just to collate data from across the region, working with local colleagues, so I have kind of a partnership with one or more specialists in most of the countries involved, and we're filling in some gaps by studying a few previously unstudied assemblages, particularly things from new excavations, some stuff that's just coming out of the ground at the moment. We're checking some of the key finds that might change the story, so the earliest finds in particular countries, or finds that are unexpected for some reason or other, with radiocarbon and with zooms. Now it might seem surprising that you could radiocarbon date a rat bone, and maybe 10 years ago it would have been a bit of a stretch, but radiocarbon dating is getting better all the time, and these days it's quite feasible, at least from this relatively recent period, relatively cold climates, it's very feasible to date a rat bone. In fact, the bone we have on here, the specimen that's represented by both of these graphs, is actually from Roman Portugal, so it is both earlier and from a warmer country than any of the northern European places I'm looking at. We managed to get from, it was a fragment of pelvis that weighed, it was 0.21 grams, so really quite a small fragment. We got a perfectly good carbon date out of it, and we also got a species ID confirmation using zooms, which is zooarchaeology by mass spectroscopy, which is a collagen fingerprint method. So a method that can fortunately distinguish between black rat and brown rat, and obviously other rodents, from a very small amount of bone. So that's something that we're using quite a lot in this project to confirm identifications. Whenever we date a sample, we take a small bit of the collagen to get zooms as well, so that we can be 100% sure what we're dating. Okay. We've also done a little bit of pilot DNA work, and right now I have a collaboration with Oxford and with Jena, so rather than doing this myself, I'm not a geneticist, we're sending some samples off to them where we have sufficient material to do that. We're also planning on looking into geometric morphometrics. This is a graph from a paper by Lekolard and Holm-Biemann, where he's showing that you can separate black rat from brown rat by the shape of their teeth, by geometric morphometrics. More importantly, I think, We're also thinking we could do GNN on the mandibles to actually to try and pick up adaptive signals. So by looking more for metrics, one thing you can look up is you can look for is phylogenetic signals, particularly from teeth, which are relatively conserved. Mandibles may give us a better signal of kind of convergent adaptations to different conditions. So the holy grail would be to pick up kind of an urban settlement signal in that individual morphology, which, given how rapidly rats can adapt, in their short generation times and high selection, is actually quite feasible. Okay, so most recently I've been working in the Eastern Baltic, where I've been trying to fill in some of these gaps to try and firm up this idea of whether we have rats moving from east to west or from west to east. And there are three possible hypotheses a priori for when rats reach the countries of the Eastern Baltic. One, and this is kind of the default hypothesis amongst many of the local archaeologists you talk to, is that they arrive along with German and Scandinavian colonisation, which is broadly speaking the 13th century. So Finland is heavily settled by Swedes, the northern part of Estonia is annexed by the Danish crown in the early 13th century, around the beginning of the 13th century anyway. And there is obviously the Northern Crusades, in which substantial parts of the Eastern Baltic littoral are colonised and settled by German populations. For example, most famously the Teutonic Order, and the Livonian Order further north, but also a whole range of independent German Crusader groups, and you get a series of bishoprics set up in the area. We know that a lot of those sites have rat bones in them. So Teutonic Order castles quite often have rat bones in them. What we don't really know so much about is earlier periods, so I've been trying to look into that a little bit. So the next possibility is that they arrived in the Viking Age or the Final Iron Age from the west, so around the same time that we find them in Sweden and in Denmark and in northern Germany and in northern England, they may be arriving in the same area. Okay. The other possibility is that they're actually in the Eastern Baltic a little bit earlier than they get to the west, so before about 850. In which case you could make an argument that they're spreading from the south and east along the riverine trade routes. Distinguishing between these two is going to be a little bit difficult because actually the dating is likely to be very close, and maybe the differences between the east and west will be beyond the resolution we can get with carbon dating, certainly, but we'll see. But certainly we should be able to say whether this is the situation or whether this is the situation. Okay, so these are the results we have so far. Now, some of these are new finds that nobody previously knew about would be found in boxes of unrecorded bones. Most of them, however, are finds which have been studied before for somebody's MSc dissertation or somebody's PhD that were never published and were in an archive somewhere on a shelf and are not known or outside the university in which the PhD was written.